Hello and welcome to the Homeland Defense and Security Information Analysis Center, or HDIAC podcast. The HDIAC is one of three Defense Technical Information Center basic centers of operation. These centers cover a wide variety of technical areas that are of importance to the Department of Defense. They provide users with focused expert technical consulting and unbiased scientific and technical information through in-depth analysis and product creation. My name is Tara Barsotti, and I'm an analyst at the HDIAC, and I'm also a graduate student here at Georgetown University studying biohazardous threat agents and emerging infectious diseases. With me today is Monte Hawkins, director of the National Vetting Center at U.S. Customs and Border Protection. Prior to his current position, Monte served as the director for the Border and Transportation Security Directorate and the National Security Council for both the Obama and Trump administrations, where he coordinated policy development in areas such as aviation and maritime security, immigration, screening and watchlisting, biometrics, and information sharing. He previously served in other roles at the NSC, including as the Director for Law Enforcement Policy in the Bush administration in 2008, and the Director for Identity Management and Biometrics Policy in the Obama administration from 2009 to 2011. Monte has also served in various positions at the National Counterterrorism Center, CIA's Counterterrorism Mission Center, FBI's Counterterrorism Division, and the U.S. Secret Service. Monte is also currently a member of the adjunct faculty at Georgetown University, teaching the course Homeland Security. In today's podcast, we'll be digging into Monte's experience at the National Vetting Center. And to start things off, it might make the most sense for Monte for you to kick us off with an overview of the National Vetting Center and any other background information that you might want to add.
Sure. Thanks for having me today. So the National Vetting Center was created 2 years ago by National Security Presidential Memorandum 9. So the Trump administration created the NVC, but the concept actually dates back probably 10 years before that. And the idea was, how can we better leverage intelligence information that the intelligence community and law enforcement collects to better support adjudication decisions? And when I talk about adjudicators, those are the different parts of DHS that are approving benefits or travel to the country. So think of people applying for a visa waiver or for refugee status or for an immigration, other kind of immigration benefit. And also State Department, so for visa applications and immigrant visas. Because they need that information to help make a better decision and make sure that they're not admitting people who have malintent for the country. But there's this divide in the way our government is set up, that classified information is just very hard to get access to and to support kind of real-time adjudication decisions. And so over the years, kind of post the 9/11 attacks, there was a big push to start leveraging that counterterrorism information in a quicker way. And there were a lot of kind of one-off processes and programs designed to do that. But it was never really brought together to be a centralized flow, and the processes were very kind of ad hoc and slow. So the NSPM kind of gave us the opportunity to rethink the whole architecture, figure out a way to do this once for everyone. So supporting not only all the different intelligence community partners at once, but also all the different adjudicators, so they could all feed into one central flow, and so you don't have to support multiple different processes and flows. So the end goal is to help adjudicators find more bad guys in their application processes and design a technology to do that. So the NVC is really the orchestrator of this overall technology. The center part is a little bit of a misnomer. We aren't a brand new big center with hundreds of analysts and people. What we really are, like I mentioned, the overseers of a process and a design supporting both ends of the process. So the NVC itself doesn't own the decision-making process or own the information being used, but we brought the two together to make that happen quicker. That's the kind of the crux of what the NVC was designed to do. So not only streamline it, but also start focusing on other types of derogatory information. So intelligence beyond counterterrorism that's out there that the intelligence community collects. So I mentioned that they've been focused a lot on counterterrorism, rightly so, post 9/11. But there's a big push these days to look at transnational organized criminals, spies through counterintelligence, counterproliferation. So how can the community find that information and incorporate that into what they do to find folks in these streams? So we drive also the requirements and the policies to help those agencies get at that data to help support the better customer at the end.
Okay, perfect. Yeah. And you kind of touched on it a little bit, but if you could go into a little bit more depth of what you think makes the NVC so effective.
So I think there are a couple things. Some of it is laid out the NSPM, and some things are just the way we designed the process. So For one, it was very clear when we were created that we weren't going to take over the adjudication functions of the agency. So we weren't going to be this new competing entity trying to take CBP's authority or State Department's authority. So we really are there to support them. They're a customer of our process. So I think that was important because any new entity, if you're competing with some other part of government, there's always going to be a clash and so forth. So it was very clear that we didn't have those authorities and we were trying to take that over. In addition, on the other side, we weren't trying to access and ingest all of this kind of raw data from the intelligence community. We weren't trying to do that. We were going to let them correlate that data where it lies and just provide us results from their process. And so another thing which was nice because we weren't trying to, their folks are very territorial and there's a lot of restrictions on that data. And anyone trying to get access in a bulk way especially, there's a lot of tension there. So we made it clear that that wasn't our goal. So those two things are kind of laid out in the NSPM which helped us get off the ground. But I think also that we are designing something that makes it easier for them, hopefully going forward, both financially and from a privacy and legal respect. So some of the challenges in the past architectures were if you were a lawyer or a privacy officer at one of these intelligence community agencies or a law enforcement agency, you had to understand and dig into multiple one-off processes that your agency was supporting to understand where your data was going, how it was being used, all those things. And so with this one centralized streamlined flow, they now can become expert in one thing and have much better, greater sense and comfort in how that data is being used. And so we got buy-in from that community, which was very important, so they could support us as we grow. So I think it was, you know, showing that we are there as kind of a customer service organization, as an orchestrator and not a competing entity out there was important.
Great. So what technological advances does the MVC currently use, and what do you think will be critical to your field in the next 5 to 10 years?
So the intelligence community has been moving for the past several years towards more cloud technology. And so the Office of Director of National Intelligence focuses on, their program was called iSight. And so we are heavily leveraging the cloud architectures that they've already developed. And so that's been important because we are talking mass amounts of data. For instance, for visa waiver travelers coming into the country, there's 40,000 every single day. And so we are, you know, checking all 40,000 people every single day through all these processes. So it starts getting big numbers when you start adding in and layering in new populations on top of that. So the cloud technologies are very big. And then kind of identity intelligence, identity management type technologies that are helping us stitch together different pieces of intelligence to find this piece of Monte Hawkins over here versus over there and bringing it all together. And so those two technologies, which are very big on the IC, we are enabling them to become a big use case for.
Okay. And you do oversee the watchlisting process, is that correct?
We don't. We're actually a complement to the watchlisting mm-hmm. process. But it is a great question because we get a lot of, early on, there was a lot of concern or confusion about what our role was with watchlisting. So the terrorist watchlisting process is very much focused on kind of going through intelligence community traffic that's out there and finding the bad guys that we know about. And so, you know, who is Monte Hawkins? What is his derogatory? Why is he bad? What are his identifiers? And there's a very formal process to nominate people onto the list that first goes through NCTC and then ultimately to the Terrorist Screening Center to be officially on the terrorist watch list. We're kind of running in parallel to that. So that's the easiest way to find someone is if United States knows I'm a bad guy and I'm on the watch list, it's very easy to stop me. But oftentimes, bad guys either aren't making it on the watch list for all sorts of reasons. And so we are kind of going through all of that traffic that's out there, that intelligence community cable reporting traffic, and searching for pieces of information that may have not been brought together in time to be on that watch list. And so when we do find someone, we circle back and make sure they get on the watch list, but we aren't competing and creating our own watch list. And so we often brief with the Terrorist Screening Center to kind of show our partnership and why we believe that it's a nice complement to what they do.
In your opinion, where do you think the future of border security is going?
So I think, you know, CBP's big push has been borders out. So as much as we can do before the person gets here to the country. So a great example, one of the reasons why the MVC was created was the underwear bomber back in 2009, 2010 in Detroit. At that time, the policy was he seemed probably going to be inadmissible once he landed, and CBP would interview him at the port of entry. Obviously, that was too late because he tried to blow himself up over the airport as they were landing. So they pushed that check out, and so they are making those decisions before the person even got on the plane. And so in other respects, the government's kind of gone to that model and that how we can make those decisions in advance before someone even has the chance to get here. So I think that's one area. The other big one is going to be biometrics. So biographically based systems are always going to be risky because of name variants and partial information that we may know about you. But if I have your photo, you know, I'll always know who you are through the biometric vetting or your fingerprints or whatnot. So much more difficult to collect, but I think it'll be a huge piece of what we try and do in the future to support better border security. And then I think the other is foreign partner information sharing. So, you know, we have, you know, the world's greatest intelligence community. We collect all sorts of information, but, you know, we often can't compete with what those host nations have on their own people, on their own bad guys. And so the more we can exchange with them to get that information, it supports our mission and also helps them with our information exchanges. So I think those are a couple of the pieces that where we're headed and we've been heading.
Okay, great. Thank you. What is something that you would like to highlight as an accomplishment of the MVC, and what technology gave you the ability to achieve that?
So I don't know if it's actually like a technological advancement, but I think the big thing is that for government work, we actually, from the time the NSPM was signed, which was February of 2008, we went live about 14 months later. So we went from a piece of paper saying, go build this, to actually being something without a budget. So we had to kind of beg and borrow some folks to get off the ground. But within a matter of 14 months, we designed a whole technical infrastructure, plugged into a process, and we're providing results that were supporting the adjudicator very quickly. And so, you know, government workers all these days aren't, you know, in the press a lot in good ways. And I think that was this was a great example of how when we came together for like a common vision and a common focus, we could get something done. And obviously technology was a huge piece of that. So I don't think there was any novel piece of technology as much as that we all had kind of a common vision and a very like clear end state or use case to focus on. And we did all that very quickly and successfully. And so I think that was kind of what we've been most proud of.
Great. Can you tell me as an expert what keeps you up at night in this field? I'm sure dealing with bad guys on a daily basis and seeing that information.
Yeah. I think, you know, kind of what one thing the MVC is trying to get at, which is, you know, we collect vast amounts of data through the law enforcement intelligence community. And, you know, there have been multiple instances over the last 10, 15 years, 20 years, where someone got into the country and did something or got through or whatever it was. And we do after action reviews or hot washes. And we come to find out that we actually had a piece of information that showed that he was a bad guy. And we just never connected those dots and got it together. And that challenge only gets more and more difficult because we are collecting more and more data every day. And so I don't think it keeps me up at night, but I think one of the worries and what the MVC is trying to solve then is how do we better leverage that data we're already collecting, because we know the information's out there, we just haven't found it yet. And so the worst thing is to say, like, we could have stopped that, but we just didn't know, we didn't piece it together. It's almost easier to say we just had no info on that person at all, but if we had it and didn't use it, it's even worse. And so how can we better leverage all that information and intelligence that we already collect is what, you know, I think what I've been driving to do with the MVC.
So kind of going off of that, if you could implement one policy, what would it be?
You know, I think it's I don't know if it'd be a new policy, but it would be trying to reinvigorate previous information sharing policies within the federal government. We are a very stovepipe government that often doesn't talk across agencies. Key findings post 9/11 of the 9/11 Commission report was information sharing and better access to information. And the counterterrorism field has gotten much better, and so we do a good job there. But you know, the further we drift away from 9/11, the more and more people kind of fall back to their old ways of doing business, and it's just not helpful when we have kind of tribal views of your data and not sharing it and being very protective. And so I still like that ethos and going back to, you know, this is U.S. government data. We're all in it for the same cause, and we need to share it more broadly and leverage it in better ways. Because every agency has, you know, their own unique tools and analysts and points of view and things that other folks may not understand or know about their own data. So I've been working in that area for a long time, and that's a constant thing I try and focus on at 5-4 is just better access to data and leveraging data. But I mean, balancing, you know, concerns about access and sources and methods and all that, but I think information sharing is going to be a constant challenge for the government, and another thing that MVC is trying to support and help.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Is there anything else that you want to add or discuss?
No, thank you for the interview.
Okay,
good.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Thank you for your time.
Sure.
And thank you for participating with the HDIAC podcast.